Finally.
Okay.
And what a lovely review, Yamanju. So lovely. Thank you. And what a beautiful sari you're wearing.
Thank you.
She wore, I believe she wore a red sari to do the review.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so lovely.
I wanted to just feel like part of the tapestry. The film is so red and, you know, it was so beautiful. There's something so lovely about the film. And you, Tripti. And
thank you.
Anmita, it was such a empowering film, more than anything else. I think, you know, like we spoke last, the collective angst is all women just love the film. It was like that.
Yeah.
Right. So, recreating the 1881 Bengal, you know, how much did it take? There's a lot of research there because it's so minute and detailed because there's so many elements to recreate. It's like a period, you know, that you recreated. So, how long did it take for you to just put these, you know, fine details in place and things like that?
So, in terms of execution, we prepped for 3 months. Those 3 months, we researched, we talked, we discussed. With the Meenal and Veera, everybody, my production designer Meenal Agrawal and Veera, the costume designer, and my DOP Siddharth Devan, we just sat and went into each nuance, each detailing, so that as much as we could be authentic to the period. We didn't want to, you know, mess up in that detail. And so that it looks effortless. Once it finally comes out, it just looks like part of the whole canvas, keeping in mind the aesthetics and the beauty of that period and of what the film, according to us, demanded. So yeah, it took us about 3 months to put it together. Plus before that, I was doing my own little detail-oriented research. Yeah. So that research, in fact, even spilt into Tripti's prep. Because from how did those women behave, what was their world like, everything, Tripti also worked really hard to get into the zone of what were the women of that time like, you know, in terms of their body language.
Yeah, and also you watched a lot of YouTube videos, how to drape a sari, Tripti, is something that I read.
No, actually, Anmita, I did watch a couple of videos on that, but I think Anmita on the very first day, she's like, get a sari. Don't come here without a sari and jewelry. So, yeah, I would, you know, sit in workshops wearing saris draped in Bengali style because she wanted me to be completely, you know, very comfortable in those saris because, you know, in today's times, we don't like wear saris on a regular basis. We hardly wear it like once a year for some function. So I was, you know, it was difficult for me to initially walk wearing a sari, especially in Bengali style. Sometimes I would like trip on it and fall down, and then she used to just sit and make fun of me. But she said, just wear it, and you know, after a point, you'll get comfortable with it. And she actually taught me how to drape it like perfectly in a Bengali style, and I learned it from her. And then every day before the workshops, I would just drape my sari, put my jewelry, put makeup on, and then sit there like as Bulbul. So I think on the third or the fourth day, I was very comfortable. Like I could like sit, walk, do run wearing a sari. So that I think that was very useful.
And you looked beautiful in them. And I believe, Anmita, some of the saris were yours and some of the saris were yours.
Yeah.
Yeah, some of the saris were mine. Some of the saris were Veera's. We just got very excited and started getting our own Banarsis for Bulbul. And sometimes we'd be like, Veera would be like, are you sure you want to give this one? because our especially the younger Bulbul is fidgety. That's her personality. She's fidgety and slightly restless. And she had Alta and all of that and Sindoor. I was all over the saris, but that was part of the character. And I was like, you know, I would live with this red smudges on my saris for the rest of my life for Bulbul because it's so special for me. And it's her. I'm draping her in it, so I'm absolutely fine. So yeah, some of the saris were ours. We all of us, you know, treated, which was so lovely that Veera, everybody, Meenal, Devan, we all treated it like it was ours, you know, like it's like a project that is more like something that friends are getting together to make. And it felt very personal. So yeah, that was lovely that everybody kind of pitched in.
How did you, you know, when you met Tripti and you knew that this was Bulbul, how did that happen? When, I mean, how many people did, I mean, what happened? Tell me the process of discovering Bulbul.
So we had been auditioning many girls before we found Tripti. And I saw her audition. And the thing was that there was something in her which she was not doing consciously. So she had auditioned. She had no idea about the script. So she didn't really know the character. She'd been given one scene, but she'd given the scene of 25-year-old Bulbul. You know, the older, more contained Bulbul. So she was in the audition, she was enacting that part, you know. She was being that, you know, that that I'm this graceful and very, very contained and complete.
Trying to be 25.
And, but her, you know, so she was being all like elegant and, you know, saying her lines and very nicely. But that's the first scene that in the film that you see the older Bulbul with Satya when he comes back from London. And she's sitting on the jhula, that scene she was doing. But her hands were fidgeting. They were worrying. And her eyes looked like the 20-year-old. And I was like, she's doing the 25-year-old scene, but she is the 20-year-old Bulbul. And that, and fragility, and like, you know, my producer, Karnesh also, and Anshay, they saw the audition. It was really funny, actually. Anshay had been recommending that, you know, watch Laila Majnu, look at the girl and the boy in Laila Majnu, but I'd never gotten around to it. So both Karnesh and I had not seen it. So we had no idea she was the girl from Laila Majnu. And then Karnesh also saw it. He says, you know, you keep talking about your Bulbul is straight out of a Raja Ravi Verma painting. And this girl really looks like that, you know. So somewhere that then, but I was like, okay, what I'll do, round two happened with her, which did not happen with other actors. We reached round two with her, which is when I auditioned her. In that audition, I mean, she brought me down to tears. You know, I was watching her. We're auditioning and in the office. I mean, there's nothing. She knows nothing. I just gave her a brief on who this person is, what's the story, told her about it. And she just, both the casting director was there. He was shooting it. He was playing Indraneel in that scene. You know, yeah. Abhishek was playing Indraneel.
Abhishek Banerjee.
And yeah, and Abhishek and I just looked at each other and we just smiled. Like, we're like, we found our Bulbul. And that's how it happened. And then she worked so hard. We prepped with her. What, Chidiya? 2 months?
2 months, yeah.
Two months of every day.
So I want you to tell me about, how did you feel during the audition, Tripti?
During the audition, so honestly, you know, I was supposed to be in Delhi on the day of the audition for a shoot. But luckily, that shoot got cancelled last minute and I was in Bombay and I got a call from Casting Bay and they were like, there's this very interesting role for you. Just come and test for it. And, you know, the film is based on you. So you come and do it. I said, okay, I'll do it. Then I went and did it. But then, as Anvita just mentioned, I was just given one scene and I had no idea about the story or this character. Then the next day, I got a call again from the agency and they said, Anvita wants to meet you, the director. And I went and met her. And that's where she narrated the story to me. And I was like, wow, I want to tell this story and I want to play this part. And she wanted me to like know the story really well and, you know, have a little bit of a background of the story and the character before testing me, because she was like, I want you to know what her life is and I want you to know this person before testing, because, you know, that will help. I said, okay. So I went back home, lived with it for a night, and then the next day I tested for it with Abhishek Banerjee. And Anvita was like, just have Maggie, have noodles, you know, you've cried a lot, you've cried your eyes out, just, you know, just be, please feel comfortable. And I could see that they're all happy with the test, but then I was like, okay, I'm not going to react to it. Then I went back home and then there was no message first for 2 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks, I believe. And I was freaking out. I was like, I messaged the casting director. I said, listen, you have to tell me, even if I don't get selected, just let me know. And he's like, yeah, I'll tell you, don't worry. And then I think I was in Uttarakhand attending some function, and that's when Anvita called me. I'd saved her number as director Bulbul then, and she called me and she said, and I was about to like go on stage and I was already nervous, and that then I saw her, you know, calling me. I was like, shit, not now. And then I picked it up and she said, hi Bulbul. So that's how she broke the news to me, which is very sweet. And Yeah, it's been one crazy journey since then.
Okay, and there's something very, very intriguing about her smile, which I think the half smile, the Mona Lisa smile that she has in the film, you. And was it written like that? Or when you saw her, you decided, okay, this is something that she has, which is pretty unusual. Because there's this hidden smile that she...
Look at the smile, Chidiya. This one has this smile. This one has got this smile of a five-year-old. When we were prepping for it, not on paper, but as a director, I knew that the grown-up transformed Bulbul has that enigmatic smile, that almost like, you know, she is witnessing the world, that she's amused by that, that there's another, she knows the truth. You know, whatever anybody might be saying, whatever might be happening, she knows the truth, and that almost amuses her. You know, that kind of sardonic kind of a smile. While we were prepping for it, and while Tripti was transforming into the 25-year-old Bulbul, I have to say that smile came organically.
Yeah, I don't remember you telling me that. Yeah,
he became so. My entire efforts were that she has to become Bulbul, and when she became Bulbul, she automatically started doing the things that Bulbul would do. So that was magical to watch her transform into this woman. So it was beautiful because that one's a very powerful woman. You know, and she became that, you know, so.
And also the avenging woman, the fact that trees and, you know, actually climbing those trees and all, there's a lot of physicality to her. I mean, on one side, she's this, she's sitting there and she has people to attend to. And the other side is the complete contrast of it. So, you know, balancing these two worlds. And again, did it take a lot of workshops? How did you get into the other side of the character? Because one is very, very contained and very composed, and the other one is pretty, you know,
she's free.
Agile and
free. Yeah, it did take a lot of workshops. As we just mentioned, we were lucky that we had 2 months to prep for the character. And, you know, we spent a lot of time together, I guess, Anvita and me. Entire December or Jan, I was just with Anvita all the time. And we would, you know, sit and discuss Bulbul's life, what are the characters that are there in her life, what's her relationship is, you know, with either Satya or Indraneel or Vinodini. So that's what we just used to sit and discuss, you know, all these aspects of Bulbul's life. Because she wanted me to, you know, be fully prepared and know everything about this character and her world even before getting into workshops with Atul Mongia, who's done a, you know, 10-day course with us specifically for the film. And Anvita, I think, wanted me to focus on this girl's relationship with, you know, all the other characters in that workshop, because this is a person who shares a unique equation with all of them. You know, she'll be different with Satya and a completely different person with Vinodini. So that is something that we needed to work on at that point. And she, you know, has a very unique way of working. She would never give you scenes to read or never give you, you know, scenes from the film. Ki, achha, ye scene hai, do this scene. She is someone who gives you situations. Ki, this is the situation. Now you're Bulbul. Now you go and act. So, you know, what happens is when that happens for like 2 months or 3 months at a stretch, then you force yourself to think like the character or walk like the character. And when you do that for, you know, for 2-3 months continuously, then a part of it comes to you. So that helped, you know. These were very different exercises that I got to do, you know, while the prep was on. And it was something new and very useful and very helpful.
Even the physicality, Manju, of the girl on the trees was also from the fact that I took her back, that imagine what you must have been like before you got married. You're a girl who climbed trees to pluck mangoes, and you were free. You could run wild. And there is also the grace and beauty of the 25-year-old. So we used to, in fact, even practice with her we watched ballet videos. We used to make her walk on her toes so that she gets that grace and at the same time that ease of moving her body a certain way. And then, of course, once the action director Rod came on board, she practiced working, climbing, jumping, falling, those kind of things that she learned. And it was really interesting. There were the hard bits were supposed to be done by a body double. So she was only supposed to, you know, how actors are supposed to take the landing shot, but not really do the jump, that kind of stuff. You know, leaping from a tree and things like that. And but what happened due to some unforeseen circumstances, the correct body double did not reach sets. As in the body double who was her body type. So I couldn't, and it was very stressful. And this sweet little thing came up to me and she said, "Main kar dungi." And I was like, you know, it's very hard. It's brutal on your body to do action. And you can get hurt. And then she was like, so fortunately it was schedule end. Also, she also said that it's schedule end. It's okay. It's not like if I get hurt, it'll affect the film. And she did all of her own action. And in that action, she would do the grace and the beauty of Bulbul, but actually doing really brutal action. And she used to get hurt, but she was just such a sport. She was just, and she did it. It's not like anybody had to ask her. In fact, we all tried to dissuade her. "No, no, we'll manage, you'll get hurt." But she was like, "No, no, I'll do it." And she was like, "No, I know you want it like this. And you know you want Bulbul to look a certain way when she's doing her action. I'll do it." So she did everything on her own.
She owned the character.
She owned the character, totally. I used to say that, you know, if I wake you up from deep sleep, you should be Bulbul. And she was. She was really like that. She had become Bulbul. It was amazing.
The canvas of the film has a lot of pain. It's got anguish. It's got a lot of brutality. But it also has poetry, which soothes the whole thing down. It's got aesthetics. It's got these beautiful... So pain is such a beautifully, you know, channelized emotion here in the film that I felt. That the entire film becomes such an artistic experience despite the pain. So as a writer, how did you, you know, put it all together like this?
So I think it's a combination of things. I've always loved lyrical writing. I'm a reader more than a watcher. And when you read really beautiful literary works, there is a certain kind of lyrical quality to it. There is a certain kind of poetry to it. And I like writing like that. And visually as well, I have a sense of aesthetic. It's very important for me. Beauty is very important for me. Art is very important for me. I think it's one of our greatest achievements as a race, as a, you know, the human race, what we have really, really achieved. One of the most beautiful things that we have is an imagination. And that we have the ability to create art. These are the two things that save us, and these are the two things that make us different from, you know, other species. And that to me is something to be celebrated, something to be celebrated every day and enjoyed every day. And yes, there is pain because the story it's a tragic, tragic story. So regardless, even if it was comedy, it would have had aesthetics. So it is something that is very, very important for me. It's something that I believe we should celebrate. So it comes naturally. And fortunately, everybody that I had on board, all my HODs, have very similar aesthetics or very similar love for aesthetics. So whether it's Meenal or Devan or Veera, we are in love with beauty. And so all of us had a very similar vision of attention to detail and of celebrating beauty. That's very important for us.
Also, there are scenes in the film which you probably went to Tripti and said that, "Are you okay? Are you all right?" Because there are these two wild...
Yeah, every scene, every time.
So because there was tragedy, there are scenes which have physical tragedy in it, but there is emotional tragedy throughout the film. Yes. So I had to love her a lot.
Yeah, yeah. And she did that, you know, even not just in that scene, and after every scene, you know, she would just come sit next to me and be like, are you okay? Am I like, do you want me to get something for you? And, you know, people used to joke around on the set saying that Anvita has adopted you. You are an adopted child now. But that's how I felt, you know, she took care of me as she would of a daughter if she had one. She's, you know, the same as my mother. So I think, you know, she just made me feel very special on the set. And, you know, I could feel that I have people around me who actually love me and who actually care about me, not just as an actor, but as a human being also. And that just, you know, that takes the stress off you. And then you're like comfortable. Then you can, you know, only focus on your work, knowing that there's no one here, you know, to judge you or to do anything. But there are people who love you and who love the you know, work that you're doing. So, yeah, that just made me feel very happy and, you know, very comfortable, which is why it was easier for me to even do those two scenes, you know, the scenes that you were talking about, the bogus scene and the rape scene. They were just very nice to me all throughout the shooting process, all of them, especially Anvita.
And also Rahul Bose was very helpful during those two
scenes. Yeah, he was. Like, honestly, initially I was a bit intimidated by him because I'd heard, you know, things like he's a very serious actor and that he only talks about acting, and so I was like a little bit scared, and I was like, I am not going to talk to him, I'm going to stay away from him. But I think, you know, he's actually the opposite of that. He's the most fun person on set, and, you know, even before these two scenes he called me and he said that, Tripti, I'm going to be there with you as your co-actor if you ever need me. But he actually was there. Like, after every cut, after every shot, he would just come and sit next to me, break out from his zone, and, you know, try and talk to me like a kid. So I was like, wow, this is, you know, very special. People don't do it. Like, you don't get to work with such people on a regular basis. So I just felt very lucky and felt very comfortable. So yeah,
she's very easy to love, Manju. She's very easy to love, and I think all of us loved her with that same intensity, and not just as a human being and also as an actor, because she brings herself 100% to the job. Rahul was like, I'm in awe of this girl, he used to keep saying. So I'm in awe of her as an actor. And as a human being, you just have to love her. You know, you just have to love her. It's true. All of us were completely and still are smitten by our little Tripti Bindu.
Billy.
My Billy cat.
You see that the old world romance was more real and more honorable. Is that... Also, there's somewhere not clearly stated, but there is this, of course, there is patriarchy, there are different kinds of men in the film, but there's also everlasting love, which is also shown through these characters. So tell me a little bit about that.
So actually, it was a romantic period. Romance was the ideal romance was in literature really, really glorified at that point in time. And actually, by showing an idea of what that romance is, what I actually was trying to say is that there's no such thing as an immortal beloved. Mm-hmm. That this is a romantic ideal, but your actual immortal beloved, your everlasting love is you, yourself. That is what I was trying to convey, that yes, this idea of romance will be there and it will be very beautiful, and you will find different versions of it in the film. But the true romance that Bulbul has is with herself.
Yeah,
that is her victory.
So this is a question for you, Anvita. It is, did it have to end like this? Because you would want Bulbul to continue doing what she did. So as an idea, yes, it continues in another realm. But did you, because I don't want to give away the ending and then people might have not watched it too.
Oh yeah, we've been talking like with full spoilers either or. You know, the reason why I took it to that end, and the reason why I took it to a really, really, how do I put it? The lowest part of her life, the darkest corner of her mind in the film as well, in the middle of the film and at the end, was because I wanted to say that this is how bad it can get, you know. I needed to show the extreme end of the spectrum of life, of how people can be treated and are treated, to make the story more, obviously, the story more dramatic, yes, but the story more impactful. You know, I wanted to emphasize that the degree, of course, it doesn't have to. She had already evolved. She was already strong. She was powerful. But when I say when the end is actually not just her end, that the level of the tragedy is not just about Bulbul per se, but it's also the end of that people will destroy systems or safety nets. They will destroy everything around you just so that they can destroy you. Or just so that they can stop you.
It's like, you know, the forest.
That is the reason why I took it there. Also, we might, and it's a story. I took a creative call to take it there. But the reason why I don't read newspapers is because when I open newspapers, I read worse things in them that are done to women. And I am, in a fable-like form, showing you that where how bad it can go, how wrong can a fairy tale go. You know, we're all like the romance that you spoke about, the romantic ideal of the prince and the princess and a happy ending. No one tells you what reality is. So within the fairy tale, I wanted to tell you this is how bad it gets. So yeah.
I don't have time for other questions, but it was lovely chatting with both of you, and let's catch up soon later on phone and chat.